Christian Audio presents Disruptive Witness, Speaking Truth in a Distracted Age by Alan Noble. Narrated by Sean Patrick Hopkins. For my mother, Brenda, who taught me to read, to learn, and to think. Introduction. What if the vast majority of our conversations about Christianity are not really about our faith at all? What if we are so accustomed to thinking about our beliefs in terms of personal preferences, like sports teams or our favorite brands, that when we try to share the gospel with someone, neither of us are actually thinking about the existence and lordship of a loving God who died on the cross for our sins? Even if, by some chance, one of us does manage to envision the idea of a transcendent God, it is only for a moment, because we just got a text message from our spouse about what to have for dinner tonight. Then we check Twitter, and then we read an article, and then it's gone. What if our most passionate and articulate conversations about the gospel with our unbelieving neighbors are actually orchestrated social games, which both sides leave without having wagered anything? We walk away satisfied that we scored some points, and then unlock our phones and forget it ever happened. We may genuinely believe we shared the gospel, but all we did was participate in a kind of rhetorical dance that didn't haunt or unsettle our neighbor at all. Our neighbor knows there are other beliefs out there, other religions and philosophies to choose from, and besides, there are so many more interesting and distracting things for them to do than to reflect on the gospel. So they leave the conversation untouched by our words, and we leave feeling vaguely pleased with ourselves. The work of conviction and calling is the Holy Spirit's, but different times and cultures present different barriers to hearing and comprehending the good news. Identifying, understanding, and overcoming these barriers with God's grace and wisdom has always been the Christian's holy task, whether our neighbors are devout Jews, Greeks worshiping an unknown God, or contemporary Americans. And I believe the convergence of two major trends in our own time calls for a new assessment of the barriers to faith. This assessment involves much more than how to overcome objections to faith, but also the extent to which the church in America has accommodated ideas and practices that make it difficult for us to bear witness. These two major trends are, 1, the practice of continuous engagement in immediately gratifying activities that resist reflection and meditation, and 2, the growth of secularism, defined as a state in which theism is seen as one of many viable choices for human fullness and satisfaction, and in which the transcendent feels less and less plausible. One result of these trends is that, as evangelicals, when we speak of Christianity, we cannot assume that our hearers understand the faith as anything other than another personal preference in an ocean of cultural preferences. In such a world, the work of witnessing and defending the faith must involve rethinking how we communicate. The electronic buzz of the 21st century, combined with the proliferation of personal stories of meaning, what I call micro-narratives of justification as opposed to meta-narratives, has helped create what we may call distracted, buffered selves. The Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor coined the term buffered self to refer to the way modern people imagine themselves to be insulated from forces outside their rational mind, particularly supernatural or transcendent forces. The buffered self is a particular result of living in the closed physical universe. Taylor calls it the immanent frame, in which everything has a natural explanation. Nearly all contemporary Western people, including Christians, use this frame to interpret the world. Our pervasive culture of technological distraction dramatically exacerbates the effects of the buffered self, which in turn feeds the demand for technology of distraction. It is not a coincidence that these two factors have arisen at this point in history. the rise of secularism has inspired a view of technology and fullness rooted thoroughly in this life and established and chosen inwardly, which I believe has helped to justify the creation and adoption of technologies that are not directed toward human flourishing, but instead help us project our identity and remain distracted. Outside of a culture of virtue grounded in an external source, science, technology, and the market have been driven to produce a society that prioritizes the sovereign individual. The modern person experiences a buffer between themselves and the world out there, including transcendent ideas and truths. The constant distraction of our culture shields us from the kind of deep, honest reflection needed to ask why we exist and what is true. The value of individual choice and the multiplication of micro-narratives shield us from committing to a consistent and coherent worldview. This allows the modern person to debate religion and politics freely without any anxiety about what is at stake, because very little is at stake. Between the buzz of our lives and the fluidity of our narratives, there is no reason any truth should ever threaten our understanding of the world or ourselves. Perhaps as a result, Christianity and atheism have never been as debated as they have in the last decade. But because of our buffered selves, what is at stake in such debates is a sense of superiority or social accolades, not whether we must sell everything we have, give to the poor, and follow Jesus. Speaking to the kind of culture I've described requires a different kind of rhetoric than what we may be accustomed to. Often, direct conversations about God, sin, and salvation can be easily co-opted into one of the hearer's narratives without any real obligation on them. I witnessed a moving example of this phenomenon when I worked as an English tutor at a camp for high school felons. Most of the felons came from communities defined by gang culture. Their uncles and fathers and brothers were all in the gang, and so it was natural for them to join that lifestyle too. If given the freedom, the boys loved swapping stories of violence, drug and alcohol abuse, or sex. What fascinated me was that a good number of them also believed in God and were open to hearing about the gospel. They would speak contritely about their sins and their desire to change, but ultimately, most of them would conclude that they were stuck. They knew they were sinners, they knew their lifestyle would kill them and make their mothers cry, and that God would condemn them. But it was too late to change, they would insist. It took me a few months to realize that for many of these youths, Christ dying on the cross for their sins and rising again was not a reality. It was just another character or plot point in the drama of their lives. The narrative of a violent criminal who knows his sin and yet can never fully leave that lifestyle is much more tragic and moving than the story of a man who is unquestionably reprobate. There was an element of Greek tragedy to their view of God. They were tragically caught in a life of defiance against God. When I spoke to them about the saving power of Christ, I conceived of it as a reality, with its roots in historical past, its implications for the present, and its hope for the future. But they saw it as a foil in their own, more immediate and satisfying drama of life. And maybe the way I presented the gospel made it hard for them to imagine Christ as real. In a culture where the gospel can be so easily co-opted into individual narratives without any honest spiritual response by a person, how can we witness to the truth of the gospel and defend it so that it goes beyond the hearer's buffer? The first and most important answer to any question about effective witness and apologetics is reliance on the Holy Spirit. God is the one who works His will, and He will call people to Himself. But we are still obligated to plant the seed. Moreover, we are obligated to plant it well. So, the question for modern evangelicals in America is, how can we plant the seed of the gospel deeply into the soil so it might take root? We need to plow. One of Christ's most well-known parables is the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13, verses 3 through 9. in which Jesus describes how people receive the gospel. Some seeds fall on a path and are eaten by birds, representing those who do not understand the word. Some fall on rocky ground and soon wither, representing those who receive the word but abandon it when suffering comes. Some fall among thorns and are choked, representing the deadly cares of this world. Finally, some fall on good soil and produce a hundredfold, representing those who hear and understand the word. If you have spent any length of time in the church, this parable is very familiar to you. So familiar, perhaps, as to become trivial. But have you ever thought about this good soil? How did it become good? Imagine the sower going down a path to his fields to sow the season's crops. As he reaches the edge of the field, he begins spreading the seeds, and because he has just stepped off the path, some of those seeds unintentionally fall on it. But what is the field itself like? Are we to think that our sower walked to some vacant field and began casting seeds willy-nilly, indifferent to the quality of the soil? No good farmer would plant this way. Before the action of Christ's parable begins, the sower has been to this field. He has worked it, maybe for days, plowing the ground, pulling weeds, moving rocks. The sower can't remove every rock and weed. Some seeds will inevitably wither or be choked, and no sower can guarantee the yield of the crop. But by cultivating the ground, the sower can help the seed take root. Unlike the gentle act of sowing seeds, a plow's work is violent, disruptive, and exhausting. It unsettles the ground. It softens by tearing up. When a field has been plowed, it no longer appears the same. The hard surface has been broken to reveal the vulnerable but fertile womb of the earth. It is much easier to simply cast the seeds and hope for a harvest, but a good farmer knows that the ground needs cultivation. This is the work of witnessing in the 21st century. We need to focus on what takes place just before the parable of the sower begins. Our task is to communicate our faith and the truths of our world in such a way as to disrupt our buffered and distracted culture. The ground ahead. To understand the contemporary challenge of bearing witness to the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, we need to consider our way of life in this distracted age and what effect it has on our ability to reflect, contemplate, and respond to conviction. With the help of Charles Taylor and others, we will explore what it means to live in a secular age and how this compounds the effects of distraction to create a deep and largely unacknowledged barrier to belief for most people. There are no easy answers to the problems created by our contemporary condition, but by changing our personal habits, recovering church practices that convey God's holiness, and rethinking how we participate in culture, we can offer a disruptive witness that will help people to see the world anew, as created by a living and sustaining God. The work of the gospel is always the work of the Holy Spirit, but we are called to use language that lays the truth of the gospel bare. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, "If our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing." My admonition in this book is to understand how our culture processes beliefs so we might better fulfill our duty to love our neighbor and glorify God. Part 1. A Distracted Secular Age. Chapter 1. The Barrier of Endless Distraction. The person I'm most uncomfortable being alone with is myself. And that's okay, because I've become very good at avoiding myself. For example, if I get stuck alone on an elevator and I start to feel that anxiety, the dread of having to examine my life, even for a minute, I just take out my phone and poof, it's gone. Or if I sense that I need to have a heart-to-heart talk with myself about sin or doubt or fear, all of a sudden, I remember that it's my night to do the dishes, and I can't do the dishes without listening to a podcast. Self-avoidance is probably my most advanced skill set. I've developed it over the years in response to the burden of being alone, which can bring up so many unsettling truths. Of course, I have plenty of help from the rest of society. I'm always being encouraged to read something, to do something, to watch something, or to buy something new. It's an unspoken but mutually agreed upon truth for modern people that being alone with our thoughts is disturbing. A friend once described a similar feeling of existential dread to me. He said it would hit him only when he woke up in the morning. Sometimes he'd feel like killing himself. It wasn't something he shared with friends, but he'd get this sick feeling, like there's no point to any of it, every morning. He said he needed something more to get him up in the morning. My friend could stave off this sense of hopelessness all day, except for those few moments right after he woke up. Lying in bed, he could feel the pressure of being alive constrict his breath. But once he got moving, drank his coffee, watched the news, and went to work, he was okay. He got swept up into the movement of the day, as most of us do. A distracted and disenchanted day in the life. The beauty of using my iPhone as my alarm clock is that when I reach over to turn it off, I'm only a few more taps away from the rest of the world. Before I'm even fully awake, I've checked my Twitter and Facebook notifications and my email and returned to Twitter to check my feed for breaking news. Before I've said good morning to my wife and children, I've entered a contentious argument on Twitter about Islamic terrorism and shared a video of Russell Westbrook dunking in the previous night's NBA game. While making my coffee and breakfast, I begin working through social media conversations that require more detailed responses, so that by the time I sit down to eat, I can set down my phone, too. Years ago, I would use my early morning grouchiness as an excuse to play on my computer rather than talk with my wife and kids. But now, our family tries to stay faithful to a strict no-phones-at-the-table policy. We have drawn important boundaries for the encroachment of technology into our lives to preserve our family and attention spans, but that does not mean we've managed to save time for reflection. Instead, I tend to use this time to go over what I have to teach in my first class, or my wife and I make a list of goals for the day. It is a time of rest from screens and technology, but not from preoccupation. As I drive the kids to school, we listen and sing along to Reflector by Arcade Fire. On my walk back to the car after dropping them off, I check my email and make a few more comments in the Twitter debate I began before breakfast. In the car again, I listen to an NBA fan podcast. It relaxes me a bit as the anxiety of the coming workday continues to creep up on me. Sufficient to the workday are the anxieties and frustrations thereof. And so, when I need a coffee or bathroom break, I'll use my phone to skim an article or like a few posts. The distraction is a much-needed relief from the stress of work, but it also is a distraction. I still can't hear myself think, and most of the time, I really don't want to. When I feel some guilt about spending so much time being unfocused, I tell myself it's for my own good. I deserve this break. I need this break. But there's no break from distraction. While at work, I try not to think about social media and the news, but I really don't need additional distractions to keep my mind busy. The modern work environment is just as frenetic and unfocused as our leisure time. A constant stream of emails breaks my focus and shifts my train of thought between multiple projects. To do any seriously challenging task, I often have to get up and take a walk to absorb myself in the problem without the immediacy of technology to throw me off. Back at home, I'm tasked with watching the kids. They are old enough to play on their own, so I find myself standing around, waiting for one of them to tattle or get hurt or need water for the fifth time. If I planned ahead, I might read a book, but usually I use the time to check Twitter and Facebook or read a short online article. But it's not always technology that distracts me. Sometimes, while the kids are briefly playing well together, I'll do some house cleaning or pay bills. Whatever the method, I'm always leaning forward to the next job, the next comment, the next goal. I watch Netflix while I wash dishes. I follow NBA scores while I grade. I panic for a moment when I begin to go upstairs to get something. I turn around and find my phone to keep me company during the 2-minute trip. When it's late enough, I collapse, reading a book or playing an iOS game. I'm never alone, and it's never quiet. As a Christian, the spiritual disciplines of reading the Bible and praying offer me a chance to reflect, but it's too easy to turn these times into to-do list chores as well. Using my Bible app, I get caught up in the Greek meaning of a word and the contextual notes and never really meditate on the word itself. It is an exercise, not an encounter with the sacred, divine Word of God. A moleskin prayer journal might help me remember God's faithfulness, but it also might mediate my prayer time through a self-conscious pride in being devout. There's no space in our modern lives that can't be filled up with entertainment, socializing, recording, or commentary. This has always been the human condition. The world has always moved without us and before us and after us, and we quickly learn how to swim with the current. We make sense of our swimming by observing our fellow swimmers and hearing their stories. We conceive of these narratives based on the stories we've heard elsewhere, from our communities, the media, advertisements, or traditions. But for the 21st century person in an affluent country like the United States, the momentum of life that so often discourages us from stopping to take our bearings is magnified dramatically by the constant hum of portable electronic entertainment, personalized for our interests and desires, and delivered over high-speed wireless internet. It's not just that this technology allows us to stay plugged in all the time, it's that it gives us the sense that we are tapped into something greater than ourselves. The narratives of meaning that have always filled our lives with justification and wonder are multiplied endlessly and immediately for us in songs, TV shows, online communities, games, and the news. This is the electronic buzz of the 21st century, and it is suffocating. The Mindfulness Solution. Maybe your typical day doesn't resemble the perpetually distracted and frantic experience I've just described, but there's a good chance you suffer from the electronic buzz of the 21st century all the same, even if to a smaller extent. Aside from studies and polls where people have self-identified as busier than ever before, one sign that this is a common experience is the sudden popularity of mindfulness techniques. There are mindfulness gurus, seminars, books, and counseling methods. In that ever-profitable marketing space where self-help, spirituality, and psychology meet, mindfulness dominates. This technique addresses a common problem for many, a sense of frenetic emptiness. Americans have long been fascinated with Eastern meditation, but its recent manifestation as mindfulness is distinct from earlier interest in transcendental meditation. Whereas the latter necessarily included a deep desire for spiritual growth, the former is more concerned with efficiency and being well-balanced. Mindfulness is religion for life hackers, we might say. The central principle to mindfulness is focusing on the immediacy of the present and our experience of being in this moment. To a great extent, our society has worked to keep us from this reality. We are oriented toward the future and what still needs to be done. And when we focus on the now or the past, we do so in a disengaged way. For example, we prefer to focus on which Instagram filter looks best than on enjoying the scene we've just photographed. This is a basic feature of modern life, which sociologist Thomas de Zengotita refers to as mediated living. In his book, Mediated: How the Media Shapes Your World and the Way You Live in It, de Zengotita argues that we experience our world with a hyper-awareness of representation. So, for example, when we go for a walk in the woods alone, we are never merely going for a walk in the woods alone. Our experience of nature is filtered through the Instagram pictures we take and our awareness of how our friends will experience those pictures, and how they will think about us in light of those pictures. Or we might mediate the walk through an outdoors hipster aesthetic that we've pieced together from indie folk band album covers. Or we might mediate the walk through an awareness of global warming and its effects on the environment. However we conceive of the walk, it is never simply a walk in the woods. Of course, to some extent, this has always been our human experience. We've always experienced life as an interconnected web. But with the tremendous growth of technology and the media, of life as public performance, our ability to resist mediation has declined. In our world, we have to fight harder to experience the present shorn of stultifying mediation. And that fight is for mindfulness. In addition to the problem of overwhelming mediation, mindfulness seeks to silence the voices and distractions in our lives. Typically, mindfulness training involves sitting silently for a period of time or for formal meditation. There is a tremendous focus on breathing and its ability to center us. And through these practices, we hope to learn to be present in the world and aware of our existence. While once primarily popular among those in Silicon Valley, the mindfulness movement has now grown into a major method of psychological treatment and a multi-million dollar industry. An article in The Telegraph dubbed it the saddest trend of 2015. And perhaps there is something sad about devoting such time and money in order to hear ourselves think once in a while. But this trend is not a Luddite reaction to technology. The mindfulness movement is not an anti-technology movement, but an attempt to find healthier ways to live with the technology we can't seem to live without. Although I think there's much to be said for this strategy of addressing our perpetually distracted and mediated lives, my concern in this book is with how the church can speak more prophetically in such a world. Because whether modern technology is on the whole harming society, and whether mindfulness practices will have any significant mitigating effect on this harm, for the vast majority of Americans, this overly integrated and frantic world is the culture we live in. Mindfulness training requires more time and money than most of us can afford. In this rise of the mindfulness industry, we can see a tension between technological changes and our deep desire for a more immediate and integrated world. No question, these practices are addressing a serious problem in society, but they are also a symptom of a society driven by technological innovation, where how we ought to live follows far behind how we can live. And we have every reason to believe that technology will continue to drive our world. Technological changes. Modern media technology focuses largely on two goals: capturing our attention and gathering our data. While the latter has troubling implications for our privacy, the former has a direct effect on our ability to encounter and contemplate the holy. Innumerable gadgets, websites, channels, streaming services, songs, films, and biometric wristbands vie for our attention. Without our attention, their existence is unjustified. So, each piece of technology we own does what it can to make us pay attention to it, like an overly eager child tugging on our sleeve, begging, "Look what I can do, Dad!" It is not just that every spare moment is fought for. Our technology covets every glance. Flashing lights, vibrations, bells ringing, little red dots, email alerts, notifications, pop-up windows, commercials, news tickers, browser tabs, everything is designed to capture our attention. And there is good reason to believe that technology will only continue to progress in this direction. Unless you are a mindfulness guru, you don't have much incentive to encourage your customers to slow down, declutter, and unplug. The momentum in the technology industries is toward more opportunities for engagement and entertainment. For example, self-driving cars will prevent millions of deaths and reduce traffic, but they will also enable us to use commute time to surf the web safely. A reactionary stance argues that these changes are inherently harmful to the human mind and culture, and the uncritical embrace of these technologies has led to a widespread decline in human flourishing. This is an argument that discerning Christians would do well to consider. It is important for us as Christians and as consumers to question the unintended consequences of changes in technology. But we should not naively believe that we can suddenly reverse the flow of innovation. Barring a catastrophic event or a dramatic shift in the structure and goals of modern technology, we can expect that, for the foreseeable future, our society will be in part defined by technology designed to continually distract us. Wise Christians will discern how to appropriately use new media and technology, not withdraw and rail against it. To live well in a modern world requires constant reassessment of how our society and technology are shaping us. We should be open to taking drastic steps to reject practices and habits that we believe are destructive or evil. But the vast majority of innovations will not be so clear-cut, and we will have to weigh benefits, purposes, and damaging effects individually and in community. But as with mindfulness training, whatever efforts we personally take to resist getting sucked into the electronic buzz of the 21st century, the vast majority of our neighbors will be caught in the stream. If we assume that, for the most part, society will continue down the path of adopting invasive and distracting technologies, the question facing Christians becomes not only how can we resist these changes, but also how can we speak the truth in a culture where this is the norm? But before we may answer this, we must consider how truth is interpreted in this kind of world. What effect does this technology have on our minds, and how does that affect our ability to interpret spiritual truths, to conceive of a God who transcends our material world? Mentally spent. Living a distracted lifestyle does more than waste our time. It forms our minds, often in ways that are harmful for deep, sustained thought, the kind of thought so important to religious discourse. Armed with these concerns, neurologists have been looking closely at the effects of distraction and constant connection to the internet. The American cognitive scientist Daniel J. Levitin has surveyed these findings in The Organized Mind. Levitin explains that multitasking, which we are increasingly pressured to do by our technology and society, has serious psychological effects on our brains. Multitasking has been found to increase the production of the stress hormone cortisol, as well as the fight-or-flight hormone adrenaline, which can overstimulate your brain and cause mental fog or scrambled thinking. Multitasking creates a dopamine addiction feedback loop, effectively rewarding the brain for losing focus and for constantly searching for external stimulation. To make matters worse, the prefrontal cortex has a novelty bias, meaning that its attention can be easily hijacked by something new, the proverbial shiny objects we use to entice infants, puppies, and kittens. The irony here, for those of us who are trying to focus amid competing activities, is clear. The very brain region we need to rely on for staying on task is easily distracted. We answer the phone, look something up on the internet, check our email, send an SMS, and each of these things tweaks the novelty-seeking, reward-seeking centers of the brain, causing a burst of endogenous opioids. No wonder it feels so good. All to the detriment of our staying on task. We are addicted to novelty, and, as with most addictions, it takes a toll on our bodies. We become mentally fatigued, scrambled, as Levitin describes it. In this way, the modern mind is often not prepared to engage in dialogue about personally challenging ideas, particularly ones with deep implications. The fatigued mind would rather categorize a conversation about God as another superficial distraction, requiring little cognitive attention, than a serious conversation that ought to cost us, at least cognitively. The shape of our engagement with ideas forms how we interpret and categorize these ideas.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.